So thank you very much, Sandro, for your kind introduction, and good afternoon, everybody. I would like, first of all, to thank you, the organization, for giving us the possibility to talk about this research we are carrying out. But second thing, I would like to give credit to my postdoc, Stefano Mariani, who did all this. Didn't make it to come, so that's why I give the talk. So I'm going to talk today about improvement in limited detection using pulse-width interferometer. And the improvement we are claiming is of three orders of magnitude. And but I'm not sure how many of you knows about pulse-width, how it is made, but this is a very simple, interesting and material, and the way to make it is very simple. You just take it a silicon substrate, put it in an electrochemical cell with water as some trace of hydrofluoric acids, and if you source current and your silicon is the anode of the electrochemical cell, then the silicon dissolves. And the way it dissolves, they really depend on the etching parameters. So if you take P++ silicon, what you get is random dissolution. If you increase the resistivity of the substrate, you can control the dissolution, and there are tricks to really control the dissolution. Right now, we are able to control the dissolution, I would say, up to half micron in size. So, but the material I'm talking today is about a really mesoscale material, so where the pores are in the range of 50-100 nanometers. And if you take a cross-section of this material, you can see the pores are straight, almost cylinder-like, and the diameter of the pore is almost roughly constant to the depth. And the nice thing is that if you do interrogate the materials with visible light, the wavelength is long enough to see the material as an homogeneous material. So by changing the porosity of the material, so by changing the mass of silicon removed per unit time, what you change is the refractive index of the materials. So this means that you can really tune the material. This is why you see a visible color, because this color is due to interference. So the second thing I'd like to discuss a little bit is why pulse-width that's interesting for biosensing application. Well, as I told you before, the pore dimension can be controlled over four order of magnitudes, meaning that you can tune the size of the pore from a few nanometers up to tens of micrometers. So this enables you to really deal with the many different kinds of biomolecules, ideally even from small molecules up to cells, which are much bigger. The other thing which is very interesting, especially for biomolecule sensing, is that the specific surface of this material is huge. So if you take 1 cubic centimeter of the materials where you are able to unfold the materials, you get the surface equivalent to 2 soccer fields. So meaning that you can really absorb on the surface a massive quantity of bioreceptor, which would in principle increase your sensitivity to any analyte. And the other nice thing, and I'm going to talk about this, but this is some work we are doing, and is that as the mass of silicon removed per unit time depends on the etching current you are sourcing through the electrochemical cells, this means that you can change the porosity and in turn the refractive index of the materials with time, which means that you can easily create complex optical structure. If you etch with constant current, you get an interferometer, which is the device I'm talking about today, but if you use like a square wave etching current, you get a Bragg stack, so a DBR, what is called, distributed Bragg reflector, or you can even make resonant cavities and so on. Okay, let me talk a little bit more about the use of polysilicon for biosensing. Everything started in 1997 with the group of Mike Seller at the UCSD, so UC San Diego, and they demonstrated for the first time that this material could be actually used for biosensing. So you can immobilize a bioprobe inside the material, and you can use exploit the optical properties of the materials to measure binding of bioreceptor in a level-free way. And they claim in this paper they were able to detect the picotophantomolar level of the analyte, which was DNA in this case. So unfortunately, later in the year, this result was hardly repeated. And and so Mike proposed like some amplification strategy in order to go down with the detection limit. And by using them, there are several amplification strategies you can use, for example, recirculating the solution through the materials or other strategies. And in this case, using amplification strategies, you can push the limit of detection down to the nanomolar level, but you're still far from the picotophantomolar level. And actually, recently, the group of SIGA, which is working on this platform, highlighted that these materials are really far from the clinical level because they are stuck on the micromolar level for non-amplified level-free detection. And so they proposed some kind of another kind of amplification, like focus on electrokinetic focusing of bio analytes in order to push down the detection limit to the nanomolar level. But we are still far and we are using amplification strategies. So if we look at the state of art of porous silicon biosensor in non-amplifier level-free wave, you can hit the micromolar level with amplifier level-free detection. You can hit the nanomolar level, and if you are able to use a fluorescence probe like fluorescein attached to your bioreceptor or bioanalyte, you can go down to the femtomolar level. And if, for comparison, you take a look at the state of art of plasmonic biosensor, which are at the forefront of the research, you can see that in non-amplifier level-free way, you can get much better results in terms of limit of detection, one nanomolar. And if you have amplification strategy, you can go down to the picofemtomolar level. So then, I think at least three order of magnitude better than the porous silicon biosensor. So this was really surprising to me because we were not used to use porous silicon biosensor, but if you look at the property, if you look at the surface, you are available to immobilize the bioreceptor. This was very surprising to me. And then we started working on this field, and we prepared our porous silicon interferometer. So we etched a first layer of porous silicon. We get rid of it. And this is why, in this way, when you remove the first layer, you get a nanotexture of the surface. And so this improves your reliability in fabrication, because otherwise, at the beginning, the surface of your substrate is really flat, is polished. So this is, you know, not really a reliable condition for electrochemical etching. In this way, you can really improve the reliability, and then you can perform a thermal oxidation in order to completely convert silicon to silicon dioxide. In this way, you increase the stability in water-based solution. Okay, and that's what we usually get. This is a top view of the materials, and you see there is some distribution about among pores, and the pores are about 50 nanometer in size. The thickness of the material we are working usually is about 3-4 micrometers. Okay, so it's very simple to probe the feature of the material. You just put the material into a flow cell and then shine white light over the material, and you get the light reflected. You can collect the reflected light into a spectrometer, and you get a reflectance spectrum. And that's what we did. We use a flow cell with a volume of about 100 microliters. And then at the beginning, we decided, as we were new in the field, we decided to just probe BSA, non-specific detection. This is the best case you can get because you have a silicon oxide surface, and then you immobilize BSA, a protein, on that surface. So this is the best contrast you can get. So we are monitoring variation of the refractive index. This is the best case we can get in order to prove our materials. Okay, and then we use a different concentration ranging from 150 picomolar to 15 micromolar. And this is, we had a sort of discussion with my postdoc in this case because he's an analytic chemistry. I'm a material scientist. So I looked at the literature and I told him, it doesn't make sense to use that small concentration because, you know, in the literature, no one is able to get down to that concentration laboratory way. And he told me, you're right, but it doesn't make sense to use higher concentration because from a clinical point of view, there is no sense to have a biosensor researcher. So the trade-off was, okay, let's stay a little bit above the state of art and then try to go down below this. And that's what we did. And the typical way people use to probe the sensor to measure the output is getting the reflection spectrum, so in a buffer, and then after like a BSA absorption on the silicon surface, silicon dioxide surface, and then you wash the sample and have your reflection spectrum, which has changed. The spectrum is usually redshift, and the motivation why the spectrum is redshift because you are absorbing a protein on the silicon dioxide surface, so you are changing, you're increasing the refractive index, the effective refractive index of your structure, so you get a redshift on the reflection spectrum. And so one way people use, the most used way, I would say, people use to get the output signal is to take the fast Fourier transform. If you take the fast Fourier transform, you get the principal component, and it turns out that the peak position of the FFT transformation is the effective optical thinness. So it is related to the thickness of your materials, which you know very well, and to the effective refractive index. So in this way, a change, a redshift of the peak position tells you that you are absorbing materials on your surface. Well, we take this, the FFT, we did many samples, and those are the results of 5 samples. So what is that? You see the gray area is the noise level, 3 times the noise level, and all the concentration are within the noise level. So we didn't get anything. Maybe the highest concentration here, 1 micromolar, 10 micromolar are at the edge. Sometimes you can discriminate, sometimes not. So, but if you take a look, if you take a closer look at the reflectance spectrum, you can see a shift, you can see a change of the reflectance spectrum. So we start thinking about it, we realize that if you take the FFT transform, you are just looking at frequency change, if you change the amplitude. But when you change the refractive index of your materials, you are having a frequency change, amplitude change, a phase change. So you are losing a lot of signal by just taking the transform. So then we came out with this nice technique, which we call the interferometric average over wavelength reflectance spectroscopy. The name is pretty long, but the thing you need to do is have a reference spectrum, taking your spectrum after binding, take the difference of the spectrum, and what you get is an amplification of the difference. You just see the difference between the two spectrum, and then you want to take the absolute value of your interferogram, which is the result of the difference, and if you take the average value of this interferogram, you get a signal which is strongly correlated with the refractive index, and the correlation factor is 16 times higher than the correlation factor of the FFT transformation. So, and this is the same set of data I showed you before with the FFT, and you can see these are the same reflectance spectrum And here you can see the difference that you couldn't see before. And those are the interferogram or the buffer without anything, and in the press after absorption VSA. And you can already see a significant difference now. But then, okay, so you take the absolute value and you can take the average value, and you can average over different range of wavelength. So if your interval of averaging is small, you don't see very well the signal. But if you average over an interval of 100 nanometer, you can see a good signal already. And you can see that if you average over the whole range of wavelength you are investigating, you can see a very good discrimination of the signal at all the concentration we try. And then if you repeat the experiment 5 times, so this is a sample to sample, this curve is performed over 5 different samples, so this gives you insight on the sample to sample reliability. You can see you can really get a very nice calibration curve, you can get a good sigmoidal fitting, and the noise floor is very small. And even at the smaller concentration, 150 picomolar, we tried, the signal to noise ratio is about 5, which means that you can really go down with the concentration. And so in this case, we estimate the detection limit should be 20 picomolar, which is pretty close to what you get with the plasmonic sensors, which are much more complicated anyway. So, but I mentioned before, this gave us an improvement of 10,000 times with respect to FFT transformation. But this is a best case, as I told you. We are just looking, this is not a biosensing. This is just absorption of a protein on our semiconductor surface. So we have to try a biosensing. To try a biosensing, we repeat the story, the whole story. But in this case, we perform a stylization on the semiconductor surface. Then we use a linker. Aptamer, TN-alpha aptamer to the surface, and this is our bioreceptor. And this aptamer is specific, does specific target this protein, TNF-alpha, which is a tumor target, which is really interesting for clinical application. And then we perform a control of the functionalization step, both in lab freeway and also by marking the aptamer with a fluorophore in order to make a fluorescence control. And then we repeated the test with the concentration of TNF alpha from 3 nanomolar up to about 400 nanomolar. And what you see here, in this case, we have 2 interferometers with different pore size. In this case, the pore size is 50 nanometer, in this case it's 100 nanometer, and you can see that you can really discriminate most of the concentration. In the case of larger pore, you can discriminate all the concentration of TNF alpha up to 3 nanomolar. We tried 0.3 nanomolar, so 300 picomolar, but we didn't get good signal, good reliability, I would say. So we claim that we can discriminate 3 nanomolar with a signal to noise ratio which is 10, so it is very good. And the detection limit is 200 picomolar, meaning that we lost a factor 10 with respect to the BSA and specific absorption, but still we are hitting the noise level at significantly lower value with respect to the literature. And here you see the same set of data analyzed with the FFT transformation. And again, you don't get any sense of the concentration here because you see almost a randomic dispersion. So, okay, just come to the conclusion. I talked about the possibility to use this high AW technique to analyze your optical sensor. We used this for pore silicon interferometer, but this is a more general approach that you can use with your optical biosensor. And we show that with a specific absorption of BSA, we can we do have a detection limit of 20 picomolar, and by performing a full bioassay using an aptamer probe to detect TNF-alpha in a lab-free non-amplified way, we are able to go down as a limit of detection to 200 picomolar. Okay, so let me thank the people that worked on this project, especially Stefano Mariani and our collaborator Lorena Fedeschi at the EFSC CNR in Italy, and all of you for your attention.